Well, welcome everyone. I'd like to welcome you to our distinguished speaker series. As you all know, I have been working with Mrs. Grineau for many years getting speakers to come to Newbury Court, and we've had some just enormously talented, interesting people here, and I will continue to work with Brigitte on this series, and I hope you all enjoy it. I'd also like to thank Betsy Moyer. She's here filming with our Concord Cable television station, which is Channel 8. So if you'd like to see this again, it's on Wednesdays at noon on Channel 8. And you can also stream it on your computer. So our speaker today, Dr. Jolyon Mitchell, has held many prestigious posts. He has many publications to his credit. He has lectured around the world, and he is working on an important peace-building project in Israel. But before we get further into that, I should tell those of you in the audience who don't already know that Jolyon is the son of the very talented Catherine Beck. Catherine is a resident here at Newbury Court, and she has been sharing with us her immense talent in her absolutely magnificent voice for many years. And if you've never heard her read, you should make an effort to do that. So I hope you'll do another reading group soon. Catherine, a hand. So I asked Jolyon's mother if she had any interesting anecdotes about her son that she might want to share with us. And she had a couple. She said, well, he's always been quite the risk taker. His elder sister Fiona once found him and a friend up on the second floor bedroom tying sheets together in a desperate attempt to escape the premises. You're not gonna escape today, you're sitting right there. She also said that he used to sell photographs of his three-year-old sister to her prospective boyfriends.
13-year-old.
Oh, 13-year-old. I'm sorry. 13-year-old. Are you still friends with your sister?
Yeah, we have a good deal going.
Good. I thought that maybe that was what informed his interest in media studies early on. Anyway, it's a great honor to have you with us here today. Dr. Mitchell specializes in religion, violence, and peacebuilding, with particular reference to the arts. He was educated at Cambridge, Durham, and Edinburgh universities. He was a producer and journalist at BBC World Service and BBC Radio 4 before moving to the University of Edinburgh, where he is the director of the Center for Theology and Public Issues and president of the National Association for Theology and Religious Studies in the UK. He is author of many books, including Promoting Peace and Inciting Violence, The Role of Religion and Media, also Martyrdom, A Very Short Introduction, and Media Violence and Christian Ethics. And you can also see at least a few of his lectures on YouTube, which I highly recommend. I watched a few the other day. Over the past year, he has been working with Jewish, Christian, and Muslim religious leaders, as well as Palestinian and Israeli journalists on a peace-building project in Jerusalem and beyond. The title of his talk today is Religion, Violence, and Peacebuilding, The Role of the Arts. Please welcome Dr. Jolyon Mitchell.
Jesse, thank you so much for that very warm and generous introduction. And thank you so much for having me here today. If you can't hear me, or I start speaking too quickly, and you want to hear me, can you either wave or shout at me? That would be helpful to, thank you very much. It is an honor to be here and speaking with you today, and it's also a privilege to be here and reflecting with you on this topic of religion, violence, and peace building, the role of the arts. As many of you may know, about a month ago, someone I've known for over 20 years sadly died, F. Ellis Lee, and I'd like to dedicate this lecture to F. Ellis, somebody I knew, admired as a kind, generous, gracious, elegant, wonderful man who is and will be much missed. So this lecture is really in his honour, and it is an honour to be here speaking. I'd like to begin in New York. FLS, I think, came to New York about when he was about 8. Does anyone know where is this in New York? Shout at me.
United Nations,
spot on. I went there specially to go and look at this statue, and they'd hidden it, and I wanted to go and look at it, and they I think were repairing it, but it is there at United Nations. And just by way of introduction, I'd like to show you a few pieces of art from the United Nations garden or from inside. That one is not there. However, a tapestry is there. And that's a tapestry version of it, of Guernica. Now, I know that, was it Nancy who was looking at Picasso in some detail? So I'm not going to talk a lot about Guernica, but it's nevertheless interesting that it is there in the United Nations as a tapestry. And I use it as an example of art that protests against violence. I'm sure you can think of lots of other examples, but there's one example. Or, of course, there is art that protests also promotes non-violence. You can see here the knotted gun. This is both in Stockholm, but also the United Nations garden. And then also, there is art that celebrates peace. The Japanese peace bell, which I understand is rung every Hiroshima Day in August, as a sign of a hope for peace and of that never happening again. Boutros Ghali, when he was Secretary General of the United Nations, said peace is precious. It's not enough to yearn for peace. Peace requires work, long, hard, difficult work. And it's interesting to think about how artists can contribute to that long, hard, difficult work. And I'd like to explore that with you. But some of you may be thinking, because I know many of you will be critical of perhaps this thesis, as I am, that maybe art can move in the other direction. Rather than promoting peace, can actually promote violence. So here are a couple of examples of doing that. Here's a propaganda piece from the First World War, produced by the British, to show all the terrible things that the Germans had done or were doing, such as spearing and impaling babies, crucifying a Canadian soldier, gassing people, attacking the women of Belgium. So this is a propaganda piece from 1960, and some people would say this is an example of art that promotes violence. Or art that celebrates violence. This, I'd need to take you to Northern Ireland, not to the United Nations building, but to Londonderry or Derry. The war memorial there, which in a way you could say is almost celebrating the act of violence in this war memorial. You perhaps have heard of the university, and I'm going to probably mispronounce this, so please correct me, from University of Notre Dame. Is that the Notre Dame? Yep, we say Notre Dame, but anyway, that's a... and the scholar there, who I've learned an awful lot from, Scott Appleby, wrote a very important book in 2000 called The Ambivalence of the Sacred. And there he argues that religion can both be a driver towards violence, but also a driver towards peace. And you can see there, this is a picture from the Balkans of a church that has been knocked out in a war. Some people would say driven partly by religious divides. But he also argues that actually peace is driven both by religious agents, as he describes them. So the ambivalence of the sacred. But I just want to push this idea a bit further beyond the ambivalence of the sacred to the ambivalence of the arts. And I want to use a couple of examples to reflect on that. The first is here. This is a piece that actually touches my heart a lot whenever I look at it, because I know the story. You maybe know the story of this. This is by one of the leading German artists of the 20th century, Kathy Kollwitz. And she, when she was, I think in 1914, her son came to her and said, "Please allow me to go and fight for my nation." Because his father wouldn't let it happen. So she eventually said, "All right, I'll persuade your father to let you go." And that's exactly what happened. He was allowed to fight. Within about 2 months, Peter had been killed on the Western Front. She was understandably heartbroken. And she was determined, as an artist, to respond to this in some way. But she couldn't. She was unable, she was depressed, understandably, to respond after 1 year, after 2 years. It took the same number of years that he had lived for this monument to be created. It's called Grieving Parents. And you can maybe just look with me for a moment. If you can see it there, you can see the father holding his hands in sort of in heartbreak, and the mother there is, notice how she's leaning down in grief. She said afterwards that this is almost our guilt as an older generation who pushed a younger generation towards war. And about the same distance as this screen to where the camera is where Peter is buried. So it's as if they are looking over the point of where dear Peter was buried. But you could say this is an example of an articulation, an expression of grief and of heartbreak, and also perhaps the ambivalence of the arts and how the arts can also respond to the ambivalence of violence. A second example, to return to the UN, you can see the ambivalence of the arts and religion in this piece that I began with, this picture of, it's called We Shall Beat Our Swords into Plowshares. It's by a Soviet artist, whose name I will not try to pronounce. My wife speaks much better Russian than I do. I know I met one person I know speaks Russian here, so I'm not going to risk it. But anyway, he's a well-known 20th century artist, and this was a gift to the Soviets at the height of the Cold War, or during the Cold War. Here's another picture of him. This is arguably his most famous piece. But he did other pieces. This vast piece, if you've been to Berlin, you perhaps have seen this. This is a massive, massive statue of a Soviet trooper, and you can maybe just see his sword is cutting through a swastika there, and he's holding a child, because this was based on a story. The story was saying that the Soviet child had rescued this German child, and it's looking over thousands of war graves from the Soviets in Berlin. This was by the same artist who did Swords into Plowshares. He was part of the social realist movement, some people would say. And you can see here, translation, people of the war, let's reshoe weapons of war for arms of work. So just to go back to this statue in the United Nations garden, you can maybe see here, this for me is not like somebody taking, like the sword in the stone, pulling it a sword out of the stone. It's not like Aragorn out of Lord of the Rings with a broken sword. But it's rather, you can see, beating a sword into a plowshare, an implement to use what? For agriculture. It's interesting, I think, when you look close up, this is an image of force. There's an irony here, an ambivalence here, isn't there? Because on the one hand, it's a symbol of peace, and yet it's done through violence. So you can see that ambivalence there in the artistic piece. They also created statues. I always think there's an irony here that these statues were perhaps given to arms traders. If you were particularly well behaved in the Soviet regime, you would get one of these swords into plowshares. Let me invite you to come from New York to East Germany, because during the end of the communist regime, many people would wear this badge, Swords into Plowshares. You'll know it's a quote both from Isaiah and also Micah. In the Hebrew Bible. But you'll notice here in German, Swords into Plowshares, if you wore that badge, you could lose your job, you could lose your flat, you could lose your livelihood, because it was seen as a protest. It was a protest against the militarization of education. And they, even some theologians in Leipzig, even employed a blacksmith to do what? To actually take a sword and in the square beat it into a farming implement. So this was a very subversive image. And as I go through a number of other examples, please bear this little fragile badge and this little large, tough statue in your minds. Because I think it's interesting to hold those two in mind as we travel through three places. So that's by way of introduction, just to reflect on the ambivalent roles of the arts and religion in both promoting peace and inciting violence. So what I'd like to now do is invite you to three places. So the first place that actually has changed the way I think about what I'm doing as an academic. And it's to, firstly, to think about how arts that bear witness, and I want to take you to Rwanda. Just a reminder of where Rwanda is, here in Central Africa. And you can maybe just make out here We'll land in Kigali, and then we'll drive about 2 or 3 hours to a small village here. And when I arrived here with 2 or 3 other people, I was struck by 3 buildings. They've been covered over because they're no longer churches, but they're covered for protection. And they are protected because they're seen as significant. They were placed in 1994 where something like 3,000 women, men, and children went for sanctuary, for safety, because in previous times, churches were safe places. Unfortunately, that's not what happened in 1994. The thing that struck me as I went inside was the smell of rotting fabric. And it's been organized and preserved since it was left for a number of years, actually, with all the clothes on the floor, along with a number of skeletons. Can you maybe just make out, the skeletons have been organized, and you can maybe just make out the picture here. Does anyone recognize this picture? Who is this? It's actually a picture of John Paul II, who in 1990 visited Rwanda. And of course, again, this is a church, and yet terrible violence was perpetrated here. If you go outside the space, you'll see something which reminded me of the War Memorial in Washington, because it's got, you can maybe just make out here, lots of names. But can you see also, there are blank spaces. One of the reasons there are blank spaces here is because it wasn't just one person, a family, but an entire family that was killed. So there was a sense in which they were erased. That's why some of the names are not there. When I visited there, the guide who had lost her pet, if I remember correctly, her mother, her siblings, and many other relatives, I said, well, what can I do? Just an academic, I used to be a journalist, what can I do? And she said something I will never forget. She simply, make sure you tell people what happened here so it never happens again, never again. This is one of the survivors from the Rwanda genocide, which claimed something like 1 million lives. Before the genocide was happening, there was a number of encouragements to attack the Tutsi minority towards the Hutus. One famous statement which was broadcast was, I tell you that the gospel has already changed in our movement. If someone gives you a slap, give him 2 in return, 2 fatal ones. So here, clearly this is the Sermon on the Mount being corrupted, being twisted, and being used in what was a very Christian space as an encouragement towards violence, which happened over 100 days at a higher killing rate than what had happened during the Shoah, during the Holocaust. Now, one of the things that I've been struck by is the way in which artists have responded to what happened. This is a famous piece called The Eyes of Gutete Emereta. She was one of the people who actually managed to escape, if I understand correctly, escape from the church or near the church that I showed you earlier on. And she was interviewed by Alfredo Jar, who actually was very interested in hearing her story. And rather than showing lots and lots of images of bodies, he simply showed her 2 eyes. And then created another piece, which was almost in the shape of a body, of 1 million slides of her eyes, representing the 1 million people who had lost their lives. Again, a very striking piece of art that he describes as trying to bear witness to what had happened. Another famous piece that he did was he juxtaposed pictures, you can maybe just make out, fronts of Newsweek, what was going on during the genocide. And you can maybe remember what was happening in 1994. And one of the reasons why the story was not covered extensively was it was during the O.J. Simpson chase and trial. So one of the reasons why there was so little coverage initially of the genocide was because of that. There were other reasons as well. And I've talked to a number of senior journalists, the BBC and others, why they didn't cover it initially was partly because all the top journalists were, in 1994, they were actually down in South Africa covering the move towards the first free and full elections. And they were furious. I talked to one journalist who said he was furious when he was told to go to Rwanda, though actually that experience changed his life, he'd said, the impact of covering that story. even though he was furious because he didn't know what was going on and he thought the bigger story was in South Africa. So Jarre juxtaposes those stories that were going on in Newsweek with what actually was happening in Rwanda during those terrible 100 days. That's a picture of the artist. The second piece of art that bears witness is by a friend, a British artist, called Paul Hobbs, called Fear Action. You can see here, perhaps, that he's playing with, what's he playing with? He's playing with, instead of having a fire alarm, you have a fear alarm. And inside he put a machete. He put this up in London to show it to, as part of an exhibition he was putting on. And someone got absolutely furious with this piece of art and said, how dare you put this up? How dare you? Now, Paul is a very mellow guy. He said, come on, sit down with me and we'll talk about this. So half an hour, he listened to the guy's story. And it turned out he was a soldier who'd worked in a peacekeeping force and had had to clear up after an atrocity where machetes had been used. So the art there, if you like, was a catalyst to bring back to the surface some past trauma. And actually, by the end of the conversation, this former soldier had begun to understand perhaps that this piece of art had some merit. This is a picture of Paul Hobbs himself, and he said this is both a memorial to the tragic bloodletting in Rwanda, Sierra Leone, and recently Kenya, an expression of what fear can drive us to do. Again, interesting thinking how art bears witness to some of the drivers towards violence. This is another place in Rwanda, which is a cemetery, and the translation from the gates, it's a genocide memorial space, says you cannot respond to such a determined and terrible crime except with an equal determination to bear witness. So the argument here, and I've heard it from many artists, is what they're trying to do, and many journalists as well, is they're trying to simply bear witness to what had happened. If we move south with me to South Africa just for a moment, the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, some people say that this is partly what it was trying to do, was to bear witness to what had gone on. The poet Maya Angelou said, history, despite its wrenching pain, cannot be unlived, and if faced with courage, need not be lived again. I love this phrase, this idea of facing it with courage to avoid it living again or happening again. I'd like to invite you now to travel about 2,000 kilometres. It would take us about 24 hours with Fayyad or one of his team driving us down. It would be a very long cycle ride to Mozambique. But I'm going to just jump back. We're going to just, because the great thing about a lecture is we can actually just jump back. Because I do want to show you why I put this photo up, this one. And it is very important because this is where we were met at the church by a group of youngsters who smiled and laughed. And I want to put this picture up because I don't think I want to define Rwanda by what happened in 1994. Because there's something like 1 million people have now moved to Rwanda, living in Rwanda, and it's a very energetic, dynamic country. So I think it's important not to define the country by just what happened at one period. So I see this as a very hopeful picture and a hopeful space. But if you come back, I'm afraid Fayyad and Co. is going to have to drive us back again. That's another 24 hours back again. Actually, that would have been 48 hours, wouldn't it, because we've gone back. So anyway, this is a picture from Mozambique Peace Park. And we'll, just a reminder where Mozambique is. Different countries there, just some distance. Maputo, of course, is the capital, and that's where that piece of art was.
During years of war, Mozambique was flooded with guns from all over the world. The country is now at peace, and the guns are being cut up and made into art.
The art of life is mesmo para dar esperança e dar mais vida.
The story of how weapons of war have been made into a symbol of peace. Mozambique is a former Portuguese colony in southern Africa. Following the end of the civil war, artists have been making sculptures out of guns, the same guns that killed over a million people during years of conflict in the country. Now, at least some of the guns are being sent back to where they were made in the form of art, to the UK and the British Museum in London.
So what happened is an extraordinary project, some of you may know about it, is that weapons were turned into pieces of art. So this is the second theme. We've looked at bearing witness and moving on to the second idea, which is now thinking about how art can transform violence. And I'm using this example to reflect on that with you. One of the problems after the Civil War, which cost nearly a million lives and lasted 16 or 17 years, a proxy war, were these weapons that were left behind, because many people didn't want to get rid of their weapons. They wanted to keep them under the floorboards or outside in the grass, just in case they were needed again. But one man, a number of people were very worried about this, a local bishop, and he was at a peace conference and he could not get to sleep because he thought about all these weapons. He couldn't think that is going to be a good investment for the future of this country. And so one passage came to his mind in the restless hours, and this is a picture from it, from the Hebrew Bible, from the preaching of Isaiah. For those of you who don't have good Latin, like me, here's a translation, you'll know it from Isaiah 2, the idea of, they shall beat their swords into plowshares. This was the phrase that came up again and again. The picture, this is a 16th century picture of exactly people doing exactly that, turning weapons into plowshares.
Bring your gun and we will exchange it with an instrument of production.
The way that the project works, we go to the village and they take us to the place where the weapons are.
We have been able to collect more than 500,000 guns. The way to deal with a gun is to cut it in small pieces, immortalize it. Artists took the pieces of these guns and made them into works of art. It was amazing. They came with very creative initiatives. And now we have the Tree of Life.
I'm very grateful for the British Museum for letting us use that. You can see these pieces of art in the British Museum in London. What I find unforgettable about this is the way in which villagers would take in weapons and they would give in, say, a number of AK-47s and they would get a tractor back. Other people would give in a gun and they would get a bicycle or a hoe. Children would bring in bullets and they would get back, what would they get back? They get pencils. So interesting in terms of the exchange going on. And the artist would create pieces of work such as this throne of weapons. I talked to the curator by email and he said he thought you can maybe just make out the face of the gun here. It's actually looking as if it's crying. But actually the artist said, well, no, it could be smiling as well. So it's interesting, you can interpret it in different ways. But of course there's an irony here, isn't there, in this chair, is because these weapons that were designed to do in legs are actually creating legs and arms. So there's an irony in the piece of art, and it's a skilled piece of craftsmanship. I don't think they're very comfortable to sit on, though you can maybe just see the artist here. There was a tour of this throne of weapons. I've actually tried to get it to Edinburgh, and I'm sorry I couldn't bring it with me, but they've actually decided to leave it more in the British Museum. It was taken all over the country to shopping malls, to schools, to a prison, to Coventry Cathedral, and people responded in different ways to this. For example, one prisoner said, when he saw this, the most powerful thing you can do is pick up a book, not a gun. Now, I just want to think for a moment about this process of thinking this text of swords into plowshares. And I'd invite you to think of us dropping a stone. I'm going to drop a stone now into a pond, maybe the pond outside, and just watch the ripples with me. Because I want to think how this text is now going out, and this process in Mozambique has been used in other places. In Cambodia, for example, can see there's been an elephant which has now been moved to London, made out of former weapons. Again, I don't think these chairs look very comfortable to me. In Iraq, some people are turning. And in the States as well, you can actually, there's been a process of handing in weapons and turn into other pieces. For example, outside San Francisco Town Hall, you can maybe just make out this as a bike rack out of former weapons. Or this is a memorial bench made out of 130 melted guns, and this was in honor of a young couple gunned down by an unstable relative. And then in New York, there's the Art for Peace project, which again, driven by this simple text out of Isaiah 2, where there was a guns amnesty, which was handed in and turned into pieces of art such as this angel here, which was taken to Ground Zero a number of years before. As controversially, this dress, I don't think I'd want to wear it. It actually weighs about 2 stone or something, again made out of former weapons. Or this project called Plant the Peace, which I think, if I remember rightly, it was in Richmond, Virginia, where you can maybe just make out these mud made out of weapons. This is for each person killed by gun crime. You can maybe just see here, but they plant a little seed inside, so something grows out of it and transforms the representation of weapon into an organic plant. In a church in Edinburgh, they tried to do something similar, where the children were invited to hand in their soldiers, toys, and they made a manger. This is a manger here. Unfortunately, they got it wrong, because what happened was all the children, they wanted their toys back because they forgot that this was actually an act of exchange. They didn't get anything exchanged for their weapons. So they wanted all the soldiers back after Christmas. So it's quite interesting, the whole sort of economics of it as well. So there's the text. This is back just outside the UN. Swords into plowshares, this quotation here. It's interesting to think about the impact of this text. And it goes into all sorts of places. I think we're okay. We're okay for time. I'm going to do something now. I know there are some very, very fine musicians here. So I won't apologise for this, but I just want to say this is not necessarily my musical taste. But just see how Swords into Plowshares is used in this music video. I showed this to a soldier, a good friend who's a soldier, and he said, that's an incredible video, because we were trained, the last thing we do is throw a gun away. If we're walking through the river, we make sure we keep that dry. Everything else can get wet, but not our gun. So he found this a very striking video to reflect on. We could maybe reflect that in the discussion time as well by Michael Jackson. It's a powerful piece. Or this was created in Latin America in response to a terrorist attack. And somebody saw the bomb go off, oh, not the bomb go off, the after effect, and he watched all the policemen around holding their guns, and he thought they looked a little bit like guitars. So he changed various, these are quite famous, guns into guitars. Now, before we move on to the third point, I do want to observe, you might be thinking, isn't this hopelessly idealistic? The idea of turning all weapons into non-implements. And you might actually say that. I was talking to some senior rabbis in Jerusalem about this text, and they said this is a hope for the future. And I suppose that takes us into art that imagines hopeful futures and perhaps transforms the present. This was a response to the Charlie Hebdo attacks. You maybe remember those. But notice the movement there between yesterday. Today, our hearts and pencils are broken, but tomorrow is transformed into 2 implements for artistic response. And of course, there are other spaces where there is both a desire for a hopeful future, and some people would say there isn't a hopeful future. That's a contested space, such as Jerusalem, a place I've been learning a huge amount from. This is a very contested space, as we all know. Even you can tell from the different way, the different different names that are given to either the Temple Mount or Haram al-Sharif. We could spend a long time, we could spend all evening speaking about this space. But I want to think about walls and separation barriers. But before I do that, I want to observe how you can visit spaces that tell other stories artistically and heartbreakingly in Jerusalem, in West Jerusalem, to Yad Vashem, where you can see here a number of the people, of the 6 million plus, who were killed in the Shoah. So this is a reminder of the heartbreak that took place, the evil that took place during the Second World War. So I want to bear that in mind as we look at some of these maps and spaces. Again, the separation barrier is often pointed out, and it's interesting to think about how artists have responded to this. Some artists have tried to respond to this, saying this looks like a piece of cheese, of holy cheese, like the Swiss cheese, the different sort of lands and territories here, settlements. And of course, this barrier here, a lot of artists have responded to the separation barrier, and they've done it in different ways. Artists such as Banksy, for example, to think about this A View to Peace. I want to just introduce you to one piece of film by a friend who's working in Jerusalem now, called Lucy Lyon. She's very kindly said we could use it and see it. It's only quite recently been made, but it's interesting to see how an artist has responded to the separation barrier.
A war represents a failure of politics. You can't love your neighbour if you can't see them, if you can't talk to them. A lady who brings down walls is probably my most famous work. By putting an icon, something of incredible beauty, onto something which is itself so ugly, it's a way to challenge it and to break it. It's invoking the powers of heaven, the powers of reconciliation, the powers of love, into a chasm of despair and hopelessness. A lot of people just don't understand and feel frustrated at the inhumanity that they see, and they don't know what to do. So they come to this image and pray, and they just pray that somehow all these walls that people have built can crumble, can fade away, and something beautiful can be reborn. Bethlehem is the town of birth, of rebirth. And here it's the wall just positioned on the edge of Bethlehem and the edge of Jerusalem. So it's this sort of transition point where you've got all this despair, but then also this hope breaking through.
So again, interesting to think how artists are trying to imagine hopeful futures. I just use this as one example of that. So what I've tried to do, very briefly, and I know we've travelled a very long way, is to think about art that bears witness, art that transforms violence, and art that imagines hopeful futures. I'm sure you can think of many other ways in which art and religion has both contributed to peace and to violence. But I'd like to finish... we began with some inorganic. I want to finish with some more organic examples. The picture that I showed to begin with of F. Ellis was actually of F. Ellis in the winter in this garden, in the Botanics in Edinburgh, my home. I'm about 2 minutes away from here. I love this picture because of the frame. And notice what a frame does. It draws you in, doesn't it? It draws you in there. But it also, what else does a frame do? It also excludes. So it's interesting to think about how art frames things. It brings us in, but also excludes things as well. And of course, what I've been doing today has excluded things. But something else happens as well with art. Because I'm going to do something, I hope you don't mind this, but there's not just a frame here that we're looking at, but there's a frame where you're sitting, and where you're sitting, it's a frame of reference, isn't it? So there are different frames of reference that we all bring, our own stories, experiences, imaginations, heartbreaks, beliefs. And we look at that frame at different ways. And so part of the power of art is that we can do that, isn't it? I want to just think a little bit further, not about this, which is the inorganic, though of course actually it is a spring shot back to the United Nations, I rather like a more hopeful picture. But firstly, about trees. The tree of grief, This is a monument to, you may be perhaps the Beslan hostage tragedy. Do you remember that? Where a number of, I think nearly, I should remember, but several hundred people were killed in a school in Beslan. And this is a response. Now you could say that this is actually, this is both an inorganic piece reflecting organic, because it's actually mothers holding up children. Many children were killed in this. Trees again were taken by Paul Nash. Notice the First World War, we're making a new world. Again, we could do a whole discussion of this extraordinary picture. Some people criticize Nash's work because they say there are no bodies here. But actually, other people say, no, the bodies are here in, if you like, the disfigured earth, because that's the faces that he might have seen, the bodies, the disfigured face. So we're making, so this is another example, perhaps, of a critique of not a both a lament and a critique of violence and the impact of war. But then we also looked at the Tree of Life, which was made out of old weapons. But what I like about this picture, the first picture I showed you had no children in it, but this one does have children in it, so sort of a hopeful future, the Tree of Life. So the Trees of Grief, Tree of Life, and just quickly on the Tree of Life, this is another picture of the Tree of Life. You can maybe make it out here, but also this is a different kind of Tree of Life. In 2000, in Mozambique, there was massive floods, and you perhaps remember the pictures of a woman who gave birth in a tree with all the floodwaters around. The South Africans lifted her out of the tree. This is the child who was born in that tree 10 years on. Very hopeful. So it's Tree of Life literally as an example of that. And finally, a Tree of Hope. This is in Jerusalem, and it's based on an olive tree, but instead of leaves, it's actually swallows. And the wonderful thing about these swallows is that they are able to fly across barriers. And I was talking to a Jewish ornithologist who works on a thing called, I think it was Birds for Peace, observing how these extraordinary birds don't take any notice of the barriers. And he wanted to bring that into the piece of art. So I use those three trees as a way of finishing, perhaps reflecting on some of the areas we've covered. A tree of grief, expression, heartbreak and lament. A tree of life, which is both transforming violence into something more creative and positive. And a tree of hope, pointing to hopeful futures. I think I'll stop there, because that's a good place to end as the final picture to finish with. But perhaps we could maybe bring the lights up if people have got questions or thoughts. So, thank you. Good. Does anyone have any questions or thoughts in response to, you may have other examples or delightful criticisms? Oh yeah, great. You might need to turn it on.
Questions? Well, I have a question.
Okay.
Could you tell us a little more specifically what you're working on in Jerusalem?
Sure. As the mic's on. Yeah, what we're doing in Jerusalem, and it's very much a team, is that we're working together with Jewish, Christian, and Muslim religious leaders and journalists. And the aim is to try and reflect on the way in which some of the stories have been covered in terms of, let's take, for example, the what I showed earlier, the Temple Mount and Al-Sharif, and how that's, the stories there are covered, and how perhaps they could be covered differently. Because what one of the things we found has been very interesting, actually, to find that both Israeli journalists and Palestinian journalists have got very strong experiences based on where they've been brought up and trained, but they haven't necessarily heard from religious leaders in great detail about what drives them, what motivates them. So it's partly sort of educational, but I think I'd want to emphasize that this is a project that is one that I've learned, probably the person who's learned most from it is myself, to actually learn from different religious leaders. To learn, for example, from somebody who was born and brought up in near Jerusalem and to hear his stories about why he has not turned to hate, even though his land and his houses have been stolen. Or to hear from a chief rabbi in Jerusalem to say why, as a young boy, he was beaten up as part of as a Jew, he was beaten up, and why, again, he hasn't turned to hate. So to hear those stories, I think, has filled me full of hope, even though it's clearly a very difficult space. I think the conversations I found both illuminating, but also they're difficult. And I think one of the things I've learned personally is that sometimes I think I run away from contest and conflict, but actually sometimes it is okay to have really vigorous arguments and to disagree. It's okay to say, you know, that what we're seeing here is unjust, or what you're doing here is totally inappropriate. In a way, again, part of the power of the arts, and I talked to a number of different artists who explore this, is to actually bring to life some of the things that we can't articulate with words. So perhaps a lament through music, or through poetry, or through story, or through art, is something which I think each of these religious leaders and journalists have been impacted on as well. I'm aware that's quite a wobbly and moving answer, so I hope that's a beginning of an answer, but probably doesn't do justice entirely to the project. Which has got other things. I suppose why I'm being a little bit reticent is a lot of the things that are said, we agree that we don't say what's been said outside the conversation. And that's not because people are being precious. It's just because in a way it frees people to be more honest if people know that they're not going to be broadcast afterwards. Does that make sense? Thank you. Yeah, I think there's a question there.
Don't speak until you have the mic. That's the rule. You all know that, though.
How does one maintain one's balance when you contemplate all of the terrible things that have happened to generate the art of despair and the art of violence? It's one thing to look at the tree of hope, but it's quite another to look at the tree of despair and the various other very powerful works of art that are to remind us of the awful things that have happened. And it seems overwhelming.
Yeah. I am a strong believer in the... Can you hear me at the back, okay? Is that... Yeah. In actually the power of lament. I think it's okay to say that this, what happened, was terrible, but it's interesting to think about how do we move on so that we're not overwhelmed by it. And I suppose that's why, in terms of the movement of the lecture, just to go back to the actual structure of what I was... that it was to move from bearing witness to the reality. I do think there is a responsibility. A number of journalists, senior journalists I talked to and worked with, said they felt their role was to bear witness to what had happened, but there was a cost to them. So I think it's a very, very good question, actually. And they said, actually, it could be very traumatic, and they needed to talk it through. But to then think about how certain forms of art, certain forms of action can transform violence. I understand that Nancy, when she was looking at Guernica, highlighted the tiny, tiny little flower in the midst of Guernica at the bottom. And I think it's good to know that even in his rage and despair, Picasso responded by even pointing out a tiny seed of hope. And I think it's interesting to think about how do you work on hope. I suppose actually listening to some of the stories, going back to the question that Jesse asked, the question to think about is that there are a number of people who are working incredibly hard for building peace. For example, mothers, both Palestinian and Israeli mothers, who meet together, who've lost their sons, often it is sons or daughters, and yet are determined that won't be the ongoing situation. So that's why they meet together. They lament together, but then they also work together for a more hopeful future. So I do take your point, and the intention of the art is not to overwhelm, but it is to be truthful, isn't it, to the heartbreak, but to move on from that. But perhaps the temptation, isn't it, and I suppose I'm I'm a theologian, I can see the temptation is to move too quickly from crucifixion to resurrection, and not to stay in what's sometimes described as Holy Saturday, and actually caught between Friday and Sunday. Sunday may be coming, is coming, but actually the experience is still that of despair and heartbreak. So there's that ongoing tension. But thank you for the question. I don't know if you want to come back on that or respond or add to it. No. Thank you. I think there's someone at the back there. Oh, someone at the front.
It has been suggested that Jerusalem should be made an international city. And of course, some people want the American embassy to be in Jerusalem. Do you think the Palestinians and the Israelis would ever agree to make it?
How much longer do we have?
I'm sorry, I should have asked your name. What's your name?
Your name?
Marion, thank you. Marion. That's a very difficult question. And I'm going to dodge it because I don't think I have the experience or qualifications to answer it. Not because I don't think it's a good question and I want to do justice to it. I wouldn't say, one of the things I've learned from working in Jerusalem, and I'm still a huge learner there, is the diversity of opinions.
It's all religions.
Yeah, particularly the sometimes described as the Abrahamic religions. And that's why the agency I've been working with tries to bring together the different religious leaders. And they do meet, and often they meet behind closed doors and are trying to build peace there without necessarily people knowing it's happening, but they're also trying to build a just peace. So, of course, the idea that Jerusalem would be an international city goes back, as you know, earlier in the 20th century. And the hope for that, I think the reality, as some people say, the facts on the ground will not push in that direction. I think that's the reality of the situation now. But what's interesting is to think about not just what's going to happen in 5 years' time or 10 years' time, but in a generation's time. Some people say that actually Jerusalem is the place that is, what should we say, the potential sparking point for the Third World War, but also the key to Middle Eastern peace. Now, whether that's an exaggeration, I don't know, but it is nevertheless striking how Jerusalem has this almost magnetic appeal to people to come there and to try and make sense of it. One of the other observations is that even some people say that there is no hope there in Jerusalem, but many people there working on the ground do sort of hold on to a hope, but it's a hope which isn't just about tomorrow, it's about a longer term hope as well. I'm sorry, I haven't answered your question, but I intentionally didn't answer your question because it was such a good one. I don't know if you want to respond to it. Thank you. I think there was someone at the back as well. Thank you. I'm sorry, I didn't catch the name of the person who asked about lament, because it's such a good question. I didn't catch your name.
Edith Boyden.
Edith. Thank you, Edith. And I will think more about that, because I'm aware it was an inadequate answer. But in a way, sometimes, I suppose, one response to despair or to lament and heartbreak is silence. And perhaps a better response would have been to be silent for longer in response. So thank you. Sir.
You showed in your presentation some walls. Walls are always put up for several reasons, to keep out, to keep in, to keep apart, and always as a solution to some problem. Is there any evidence that they ever solved the problem for longer than just a very temporary period? And why would they continue to use this as a solution?
Are you talking about a specific wall or more generally about walls?
Well, I mean, you can say that East Germany was to keep in. The border with Mexico is to keep out. Belfast and Israel is to keep apart.
Yeah, thank you.
And the problem still continues.
What's your name?
Dalton.
Dalton. Thank you very much, Dalton. That's it's striking over the last 12 years, I think something like 6,000 more miles of separation barriers have been built. Many people suggest that's to do with anxiety and fear, but what I enjoyed about your question was the specificity behind it, because actually each of those places are different. There's different stories, whether it's in North Ireland or Berlin or in Palestine, Israel. There's a whole range of different reasons why walls are put up. One of the things I've been struck by thinking more and more about walls is to go about, I think it's probably about 100 miles south of where I live in Edinburgh, to Hadrian's Wall. Because Hadrian's Wall was built by the Romans to keep the barbarians out, the people who live close to where I'm living now, to keep them out. But actually it became also a trading centre. And also what's striking about Hadrian's Wall now, it's a ruin. Walls do not last. They may last for 10 years or several decades, but they don't last. And even if you look at the Great Wall of China, look at the Great Wall of China. The Great Wall of China is, what should I say about the Great Wall of China? It's now a great tourist destination, isn't it? There's a whole history. We could do a history on walls as well. They've become, it's interesting, Banksy has set up in Bethlehem a little hotel which has got all sorts of artwork, but it's next to the separation barrier. So it's interesting thinking how it's now become, some people say it's become a tourist destination, which of course is problematic as well. Dalton, I don't know if that answers a bit of your question.
I don't know.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear that. So,
in reference to really old walls, Hadrian and China, yeah, they've evolved into something totally different.
I agree, they are totally different, and that was a very naughty move. But I suppose I was trying to make an argument from history that walls don't last. So I suppose that's part of the response. But I'm concerned that I may not have got to the core of your question. So perhaps we could talk afterwards if that's the case. But thank you. Yeah.
You showed us a picture of a metallic tree and called it inorganic.
I apologize. I'm sorry.
Oh, that's all right.
Yeah, yes.
And that there was a small flower at the bottom, organic flower. And it makes me think that hope is like a living thing, like a small flower like that, and that it will grow. And the more people water it and fertilize it and so forth, the more it will grow. And that it needs to be worked on to grow properly. But hope is a living thing and very much something that needs to be thought of as living and not just some dead piece of metal or stone thrown on the ground that doesn't have any future to it. So let's keep working on the living hope and watering the flowers.
Thank you. What's your name?
My name is Alice.
Alice, thank you, Alice. I think that's a beautiful picture, and I just quick response, if I may. My dear wife, Claire, who's sorry not to be here, she has been to Newbury Court and loves it. She works in the Botanic Gardens, and it's fascinating learning from her about how that works, and how some of the pictures you'll remember from here, from the Botanic Gardens, so she works here, how things are all the time, through the seasons, both dying and coming back to life, and growing. And these trees here that were planted many, many decades ago, that was the vision, a tiny vision of hope, if you like, that will come to life, and in a way does extraordinary. Today I walked this morning and looked around is it the Minuteman Park? And I was really struck by two things. One, they're saying there were two revolutions here, both in 1775 and then also a literary revolution about 100 years later, but also saying that this was a vision of the 19th century, what I was looking at, and all the trees were organized in a way that were a vision from the 19th century. I was just thinking, gosh, that's incredible, isn't it? They imagined it in this way, and then it's grown up into something very different. So to me, it's interesting to contrast the tree with the inorganic wall, because those are two very different forms of growth, aren't they? And it's striking to think how we might take those forwards. Thank you, Alice.
Jillian, thank you very much.